Welcome, welcome, welcome back, cobbers and cobettes. It's old mate I Read Reddit, back at it again, with some more nuclear revenge shenanigans. Before we throw this shrimp on that barbie, you gotta do me a solid and capture that subscribe button, just like Steve Owen captured all those crocodiles so long ago. Now sit back, relax, and enjoy the ride, fellas and sheilas. I hope you love this one. So, to put it simply, I was a little crap as a kid. I used to steal from stores and family and swear and throw things at random people walking down the street. I was smoking from the age of 12 and I didn't give a crap about anyone but my friends. They were my real family, or so I thought. And the group of all five of us would cause trouble every single bloody day. My parents, though in my later years have told me they should have been more effective in their discipline, really weren't to blame. I was just a mixed up kid. I used to think that doing all this stuff made me cool. I can't really describe how superior I felt when I made grown adults afraid of me, but it made me feel powerful, and power was something I craved when I was younger. I could go on and on about my sins, but the fact is, I was just messed up in the head. I've made amends where I can to who I could, but you're not here for self-flagellation. You're here for the revenge. So, long story short, when I was 16, my parents finally had enough. And despite all my tantrums and screaming and even some physical violence against my dad, they decided to put me in a school for troubled youth. I call it a school, but what it really was a military institution that taught discipline in the most brutally effective ways while throwing in some literacy and numeracy classes along the way. Without going into much detail, all I say that this school changed me. While aggressive, violent, cocky, and near homicidal when I first was dumped on their doorstep, the men who ran the camp broke me down. I was there for just over a year. No phone calls, no visits home, no access to the outside world. For one whole year, I had this camp and these counselors, these real-life hard-ass men teach me just how much of a crap stain I really was. By the end of the second summer, I was a changed kid. I had fought and screamed and gotten my butt kicked more than I can count. But eventually, I was beaten down. These men taught me that real men simply don't act the way I did, and that the type of path I was headed down would lead me either in jail or dead. They were brutally honest about it, especially this one counselor, Jay. By the end of my stay, I considered Jay a second father. Though I hated him at first for making me feel inferior, he really did me a favor by teaching me how toxic my behavior was, and to this day, I still think of him as something of a hero. He was the main person who deemed me ready to return home. But the backstory is getting really long, so let's get to the real story. When I returned home, I had changed from an abusive little prick to a somewhat civilized young man, ready to take on my last year of high school. I was nervous as heck to go back, since I had adapted to the disciplinary school lifestyle, but I was also excited. I missed my friends and hoped they would just accept me back, despite the fact I hadn't spoken to any of them in over a year. And to my relief, I was accepted back with open arms. One of my closest friends had moved states since I'd been away, but the other three were ecstatic to see me. Over the next few weeks, I settled down. I didn't spend a lot of time with them outside of school. My parents were kind of testing how much I'd matured since returning, and were setting boundaries on when I could go out, how long I could stay out, and where I could go, etc. I was determined to prove to them that I wasn't the same fudge-up that had ruined their lives for all those years. So I followed their rules, and so I only really talked to my friends during school. All of this is relevant because of what happened next. I had joined the school football team, all three friends were part of, and one evening after practice, all my teammates were in gym, sweaty and dirty, but pleased with ourselves. I was laughing and chatting with my three best friends so much I didn't really notice that they were the last left in the gym, but that's when the conversation started turning bad. One of my friends, I'll call him F1 for simplicity, started telling me about a college party they were all planning on going to, and how they'd be crashing college parties for a few months now, since it was easy access to girls and booze. I was hesitant about it because I didn't think my mum and dad would agree to let me go, but then F1 started talking about this girl he was planning on inviting. A girl who went to the same school as us, but no one I thought F1 had any relationship with, really. I knew her, but I didn't know her. He started to tell both of my friends, and me, that he'd been trying to get her into bed for a while, and she kept making excuses. So he planned on taking her to the party and finally smashing. When I asked him in a joking way, What makes you so sure she won't reject you again? He looked me dead in the eye and said as casually as you please, the most chilling sentence I have ever heard in my entire life. I'm just gonna slip something in a drink. It'll loosen her up. No problem. At first I just kind of awkwardly laughed, thinking it was some fudged up joke, but they weren't laughing with me. When I asked him if he was serious, he told me he was sick of her bullcrap games, and he knew that she was just stringing him along, and that the pills would just make things easier. I could not believe my bloody ears. I excused myself from the conversation pretty quickly, and practically bolted home, most likely driving through several stop signs, but I really don't remember. I spent the whole night convincing myself my friends were just messing around. A few more days pass and the conversation in the locker room is all but forgotten, though they hadn't shut up about the party, and kept insisting that I just sneak out and join them. I got called a softy repeatedly for telling them I wasn't going because of my parents, but again, I just brushed it off. Then the crap finally hits the fan. During yet another after-school training session, we all end up in the last lockers, and the friend one does something I never would have expected in a thousand bloody years. All three of them have been talking about the party this whole time. Then F1 starts rummaging through his gym bag. He tells us, "Look at this!" and tosses friend two a small bag of little pink pills. Immediately, I felt the blood drain from my face, and like a bomb's going off in my head, I heard a voice in my mind screaming, "Holy crap, this is really happening! This is seriously holy fudging crap!" It's really hard to describe what I was feeling when friend one started going into detail about how he planned on inviting the girl to the party, slipping something into her drink, and making use of one of the frat boys' bedrooms for a few hours. I was sick, like literally could have hurled everything from my stomach all over the floor as I listened to all three of them talk about how awesome the party was going to be after just describing how they were planning to take advantage of a girl. I couldn't take it, and again I ran off. I actually did end up puking later that night, going over and over in my head what the fudge I had just witnessed. I almost couldn't believe it. These three boys had been my friends for over 15 years. I thought of them as my own family. I thought I knew them better than anyone. But 1 year away and this? I'll tell you that I actually broke down crying that night. I'm not ashamed to admit it. What I am ashamed of is how long I took to actually get a grip and handle it. I knew I should have told someone, but in some fudged up way, my loyalties were still screwed. Don't crucify me for it. I know now that what I should have done. But I was 17, and these were my best friends. I didn't want them to get into trouble, but at the same time, I knew I couldn't let this crap go down. So, instead of reporting all I'd heard to an adult like a normal bloody person, I decided I'd sort it out all on my own. So I went to F1, and I told him not to do what he'd planned. I told him it was stupid and dangerous, and would ruin both his life and the life of the girl he was planning on drugging. He didn't even blink. He got right in my face and told me that the school I got sent to had turned me into a softy, that he hated how much I'd changed, and he'd been trying to change me back with friend 2 and friend 3. He even told me how they'd been talking about me behind my back, and how they planned to give me a turn on the girl once the first friend was done with her, just to show me what I'd been missing out on. Then he said something I'll never forget. He told me word for word, "I'm doing that little jerk a favor. She's a fudging virgin, and after this party, your mum won't be the only one finally getting some." I punched him. We fought, and we both got sent home on suspension for fighting. I could not fudging believe it. I was seething. My best friend had told me he was going to take advantage of an innocent girl at a party, and I was a softy for not wanting to join in? I was disgusted, sickened to my core, and I was done with him. My parents were disappointed I'd gotten suspended so shortly after coming home, but I just sat quietly while my mum cried and my dad screamed at me. I know now that I should have told him, but after what friend one said to me, I had this insane notion in my head that I was going to get him back all on my own. And now to the revenge. After a weekend of being grounded, I went back to school, and the first thing I did was seek out friend one. He was about as bashed up as I was, but he was sporting a nice black eye from where I'd hit him in the face. The second and third friends were standing with him, and they all glared at me as I approached them. Then I did something that made me feel sick. I apologized to him. I told him I was sorry that I hit him, and that he was right. I had changed, and I hated what the school had done to me, and I wanted to go back to being the old me again. And surprisingly, they all bought it. Friend 1 and I even hugged it out, and I put the cherry on top when I told them I'd been coming to the party. Now for my dumb butt teenage plan. First, I started recording them whenever we were alone together. I wanted to get everything they said about the party and the girl they were victimizing on tape. I knew I needed some kind of proof, or it would be just my word against theirs, and after a few days, I'd gotten more than enough, but I wasn't done. No, my stupid self had a plan and I was going to fulfill it to the fullest. So next thing I did was track down the girl, take her aside, and tell her everything. She was ticked and scared, but I begged her not to go to the police or tell anyone. I know now that that was stupid as well, but for some reason she listened to me. I had a plan. A crazy, stupid plan to teach them all a lesson. So I told her to tell the friend one that she was going to meet him at the party, but just to stay home, so she could stay safe. Later that day, friend one started bragging about how the girl had accepted his invitation and everything was going to plan, and I sat there, phone half out of pocket, recording the whole damn thing. So night at the party finally rolls around, and I sneak out because, you know, I was grounded. I think it's worth noting that I wasn't filled with vindication and self-righteousness throughout the whole night. I was second-guessing myself. I had doubts, but in some strange way, I felt betrayed. These three boys had been my brothers since before I could throw a punch, and I felt betrayed that they had gone down this road. What fudged me in the head even more was the possibility that I might have been just like them if my parents hadn't sent me away. It was a strange moment of realization to come to in the middle of a crowded frat house surrounded by drunken idiots. But you take what life throws at you. So the night goes on, and friend one is getting steadily more frustrated that the girl he invited hadn't shown up. I'd made sure to keep him in my sights for the whole night, not wanting him to decide that any old girl would do if he couldn't take the one he wanted. I kept an eye on all of them. I watched as they drank and drank, while I stayed as level-headed as possible with some water in a beer can. When midnight came, all three of them were plastered, and I knew that all the girls at the party would be safe by then. By this time the crowd was dying down, and a few people who couldn't hold their liquor were already passed out around the house. And now was my time to shine. While all three of them were occupied with the drinking game, I hunted in the F1's bag and found the bag of pink little pills. Here's where I did something I'm not particularly proud of, but I'll tell you anyway. I slipped one pill into three beers each and handed them to my friends. Then I waited. It didn't take long before all three were passed out on the floor, along with quite a few other party guests. I then took out a black permanent marker pen from my bag and wrote "rapist" on all three of their foreheads, took pictures, and immediately uploaded them to our school's Facebook page so everyone who attended our school would see. Admittedly, I didn't really think of this part through, since I not only did this in full view of every other conscious person at the party, but also knew the photos wouldn't last long on the school's site before they would have been taken down. But since it was a small school in a small town, I didn't doubt that a whole bunch of people would see it before a teacher removed the photos, and that's exactly what I wanted. Next came the recordings. When I got home, I got a verbal bludgeoning from my parents for sneaking out, but they stopped when I finally told them what had been happening. They were both shocked and a little disbelieving, but when I played them both the recordings I'd saved on my phone, they were just as sickened as I was. I was silent in the car as my dad drove me to the police station, receiving a lecture about how I should have just come to him in the first place, and what I'd done at the party wasn't necessary, but I felt like it was at the time. My phone had already blown up with other students commenting on the picture of my three ex-friends with "rapist" written on their foreheads. While a lot of them just laughed at them, many were questioning if there was any truth to it. It was what I wanted. I wanted everyone to know who they really were, so they had nowhere to hide. The hours at the police station were admittedly very scary. I was still debating with myself whether or not I did the right thing, but my friends had chosen their own fate. I still felt hurt and betrayed they allowed themselves to become this way, and even though I felt a little guilt for potentially ruining their future, I did what I thought had to be done. And long story short, the recordings were enough to get them all on charges of planning to commit a crime. Since the girl F1 had been planning on drugging them had been named, her parents were understandably furious and demanded all three of my ex-friends be arrested. I would have been too, were it not for the girl telling her parents and the courts that I had warned her to stay away from F1 and the party. I was charged for my use of an illegal substance, since I admitted to using the pills on my three ex-friends, and also for battery, since the permanent marker was seen as a form of assault, but luckily I never got jail time. I did get a boatload of community service though. All three of them were tried as adults in a case of attempted rape, but only F1 got actual jail time, since he was the one who'd gotten the pills, and was the only one who admitted to wanting to use them. The other two had gotten probation and community service for being accessories, but were completely shunned in our town. No one ever let them forget. I was prepared for the backlash, ready to be jumped by them or something. But strangely enough, I think seeing F1 go to jail for what he did knocked some sense into the two of them, and they wised up enough to actually get into college without football scholarships, since they were both kicked off the team. They never came anywhere near me again, which surprised me, but I no longer cared. In my mind, my friends were dead to me long before all of this went down, and by the time I moved away to college, it was all behind me. I'm in my final year of college now, and I still think about those three sometimes. I think about how, if my parents hadn't sent me to that special school, I may have ended up just like them. Oddly enough, I do miss them at times, but I know it's the memory of the kids I miss, not the men they turned into. I've thanked my parents continuously for sending me to that place, and even got some approval from Jay when I felt man enough to tell him what happened. I don't know what will happen to F1 when he gets out of jail, but a part of me hopes that he learns his lesson and moves on with his life, like I have. Jay called me a few days ago, just to check up, and I told him this whole story, which is kind of now why I'm telling the internet. I guess the moral is to stand up for your friends when you know they're doing wrong, but maybe not in the stupid way I did it. Always involve some more qualified to deal with the situations you're not sure about, even if you're a headstrong, stubborn as fudge teenager who thinks you know everything. Hey guys, for those of you that stuck around to the end, thank you for making it with me. This is quite an emotional and really messed up journey, but thank you for sticking to it. I hope you liked the video. Leave your responses in the comments and we'll have a chat about it. Anyway, I'll see you in the next video. See you later.